good evening, everybody. Thanks for coming out in this messy weather. It could be worse though, right? It could be snow in November, Chicago. I'm Tracy Matthews. I'm the Associate Director here at the Center for the Study of Race, Politics, and Culture. And I want to thank you all for coming out to celebrate the start of our sixth year of residencies, artist residencies with the Arts and Public Life Initiative here at the University of Chicago. We're happy to also have funding from the Joyce Foundation for this program, which is a 10-month project-based residency for up to 3 Chicago artists. The artists are at all stages of their career, and they work in various media, and the residents selected for the program will explore the ways in which their work can impact our city by examining issues relevant to Southside communities, both on and off campuses, and deepening our understandings of race and ethnicity. Of course, an ambitious program like this wouldn't happen without a lot of big hard work behind the scenes, so I'd like to introduce and thank the members of our team who got us this far, who made tonight happen. Dara Epperson behind the camera, the program coordinator here at the Race Center, and Nadia Suleiman, who is the Associate Director for Arts Engagement and Community. Something like that. Associate Director of Community Arts and Programs. And also, I want to introduce the newest member of our team, Nikki Patan.
Yes.
Who is the Community Arts Engagement Manager. So through this initiative and others, we've had the honor and privilege to support an amazing group of Chicago-based artists. Every year, it's a very competitive process. This year was no different, and we're so excited to introduce you to our 2016 Artists in Residence, Lauren Ash, Stephen Flemister, and Yaw Agyeman. I'm gonna sit down soon. I'm gonna introduce Eve Ewing, who's gonna be our interlocutor tonight. And then she's gonna talk with them for about 30 minutes, and then we'll open up the floor for your questions and comments and input. Okay. So Eve Louise Ewing is a sociologist of education whose research is focused on racism, social inequality, and urban policy, and the impact of these forces on American public schools and the lives of young people. She's the Provost Postdoctoral Scholar at the University of Chicago, and in 2018, she will join the faculty as an assistant professor in the School of Social Service Administration. She's currently working on a book manuscript based on her dissertation called Shuttered Schools in the Black Metropolis, Race, History, and Discourse on Chicago's South Side. Eve is also an essayist and poet. Her first collection of poetry, essays, and visual art, Electric Arches, is forthcoming from Haymarket Books in 2017. Her work has been published in many venues, including Poetry Magazine, The New Yorker, The Atlantic, The Nation, The Republic, Union Station, and the anthology, The Breakbeat Poets, New American Poetry in the Age of Hip Hop. She's also currently an editor and staff writer for the website Seven Scribes, and she co-directs Crescendo Literary, a partnership that develops community-engaged arts, events, and educational resources. Crescendo's projects include the Emerging Poets Incubator and the Chicago Poetry Block Party. So please join me in welcoming Eve and our artists.
We have an entirely empty front row and an entirely friendly panel, so consider this your official call out. Now is the time, if anyone feels moved to take the discipleship of the front row, this is the time to do that. I'm so honored and delighted to introduce formally our 2016 Artists in Residence. Just a note on the format, as Tracy said, they're going to give us a little bit of background on their work. I'll ask them some questions and then we'll open it up to a Q&A. So Lauren Ash is the founder and creative director of Black Girl in Ohm, which is a lifestyle brand focused on cultivating holistic wellness, inner beauty, and self-empowerment for women of color. She is also a certified yoga instructor, a wellness curator, and a creative writer. Lauren is passionate about building authentic and meaningful community amongst women of color, people of color more broadly, and creatives, and inspiring all people to live by their intentions and chase after their curiosities with enthusiasm, faith, and vision. Her work has been featured in Nylon, The Cut, Teen Vogue, New York Magazine, and Elle.com. She is also a co-founder of one of the premier destinations for Black joy and incredibly beautiful and attractive Black people, the monthly gathering known as Party Noir. Stephen Flemister is an interdisciplinary artist working in sculpture, print media, and new media, with practices invested in modes of portraiture, influences of digital culture, and their common forms of application. Through objects, installations, and experimental studies, Stephen explores methods of visibility and fabricated realities among social systems. He received his BA in Interactive Arts and Media from Columbia College Chicago, as well as his MFA in the Low Residency Program of the School of the Art Institute of Chicago, and his works have been shown at Hyde Park Art Center, Columbia College, the Southside Community Art Center, and the Arts Incubator, with public installations and performances throughout Chicago. Last but not least, Yaw Agyeman has performed on both the theatrical and musical stage. He's toured in the play Red, Black, and Green, a blues, and performed in the world premiere of the musical Mr. Chickie's Funny Money at the Chicago Children's Theater. The play features music from the Motown great Lamont Dozier, and he's been featured on VH1's Soul Cities, a show produced by Nelson George that showcases singers in cities all over the country, as well as on the Africa Channel's Soundtracks at Red Kiva, a program that focused on artists of African descent. Currently, he's a member of the artistic collaboration Black Monks of Mississippi, headed by the dynamic and prolific artist, University of Chicago's very own, the Astor Gates. Please join me in giving a warm welcome to all three of our artists. There are no more bios. So to begin, I'd like to invite each of you to just talk briefly about yourselves, introduce yourselves a little bit further, and talk about your practice, your life, whatever you'd like to discuss.
I'll begin. Looks like we're going this
way. Yeah, in accordance to our
shots, in case you forget. So I am Lorna Ash, and I guess it's nice to explain a little bit more. I think I get this question asked a lot, and I kind of give the condensed version, or like a shorter version, but I'll give a fuller version.
Please do.
So I grew up in Woodbury, Minnesota, which is a suburb of St. Paul. If you're not familiar with the Twin Cities, it's interestingly vibrant and diverse, but still in a very segregated way. So I grew up in a very white suburb and went to private school until high school. And at the time, I wasn't really strong in what it meant to be a Black woman. I was just like living in this post-racial facade, I think, until college, where it was also very white and conservative. But a series of events just led to me really owning what it meant to be a Black woman, and really wanting to explore that at the time through psychology, which is what I majored in, but also through my interactions with people. So that was when I started to more intentionally cultivate community with other Black people and Black women in particular. Went on to study at Purdue University with a master's degree, and I really started to hone into wellness and self-care, which all shows up in my practice now. In doing that through yoga, really was all the more aware of another aspect of segregation, which is within the wellness space and within yoga. So I think that like during my practice, I really just started to question, even though it wasn't a loud question to myself yet, why does this have to be the case? Why can't I still experience a really beautiful community with women of color within the yoga space as I do outside of my my yoga practice? And at the same time, like the summers before, in the middle of and after grad school, I was working at Penumbra Theater Company, which is our nation's largest African American theater company. And I was working with youth of color, cultivating wellness through art for social change. And so same thing, like working to reimagine kind of possibilities around what community with people of color look like. So I moved to Chicago after earning my master's degree, and honestly, I don't know what I did during that first year, because I don't think I was still like kind of getting my bearings, but a year in was when I started to meet people like RJ Eldridge, who I'm sure people in this room know, amazing multidisciplinary artist and thinker, Janice Bond, who people in this room probably know, and with them, it was when I started to really ask those questions around like, you know, Black Girl Gnome, which is now Black Girl Gnome today. But really this idea of like cultivating community and also merging in wellness and self-care. So that's really the foundation of all the work that I do, whether it's through audio meditations, which I'm very much looking forward to really expanding through my residency here, or through curating wellness retreats and events, guiding a yoga session, guiding a meditation. And I'm really interested additionally in trying my hand at some sort of like installation piece. And so I feel like for me, like I really started to own what being an artist meant last year, and for me it just means reimagining possibilities in as many ways as you can. I don't really see myself as one form of art or art, cultivating one form of art or being one kind of artist, but I know that it will always tie back to wellness and self-care for me.
About
yourself and your practice.
excuse me, I'm Stephen Flemister, recent grad student who had entered grad school thinking that I was just going to have these 2.5-3 years to be stuck in the studio for 12 hours a day, making, creating all sorts of stuff, and figuring out things about myself. However, I was a bit disappointed. I learned that there was a bunch of reading and things. I know, right? Which I really appreciate. However, it was drastically different from what I expected. Ultimately, just before I returned to school, I was painfully, I want to say, involved in advertising in some ways. I think at 10 years, I realized I was the dude who was coming to work, you know, just grumpy, you know, all sorts of stuff. Needless to say, I'm a web developer, programmer, so a team of 10, I'm like the only person, you know, I'm like the only black dude in the agent, well, not in the entire agency, but, you know, on my team, and maybe 3 black folk or something, and my group of the entire space. It was extremely painful, and at some point in time, I just began to think about how I used to perceive my practices and my passions. Very much was interested in programming from, almost want to say, a career standpoint, while moonlighting as this kind of studio artist and things. I learned that I wasn't getting much play in terms of the paintings and the sculpture and stuff that I was producing, but I found that I was receiving a bit more attention maybe as a production person. After a while, I began to look at the digital media less as a tool, less as a kind of production method, and began to take on some of these advertising kinds of campaigns and processes and began to think what happens if I apply it to, say, the labor of love by hand. So right now, after grad school, I'm probably even more confused, questioning what commercial art looks like, what graphic design means in some regards, what is a campaign that is not necessarily ran by these conglomerates and these large companies that are just extremely wealthy. And here I am with this excitement to introduce a studio practice with kind of a concern within these times to apply to a particular campaign and a direct objective.
Yeah, what about you?
My name's Yao. She said it already.
You can say it as many times as you
want. Okay. Yao essentially means Thursday. So if you guys are on Instagram, my Instagram handle is Thursday Boy. look. So, I generally think about sound a lot. I'm a singer. I've been singing all my life. I've been singing since I was 2, 1, maybe. My dad has these recordings that I'm really, really, really painstakingly looking for. But it's of me singing at 1, 2, 4, 5. And I think that today is just a product of me being able to do the thing that has just been my body and my spirit has been asking me to do. So this residency affords me a great opportunity to not only explore that more, but also explore what it means to be an artist, what it means to be a citizen, what is a, like, what is a citizen in this space, in Hyde Park, in this University of Chicago community. You know, there are a lot of, the University of Chicago has erected a lot of buildings, and I wonder what that means to the citizens that have perhaps been moved, shifted because of those erections and because of those developments. So just really want to think about that and use song, sound, photography, and just a kind of engagement through sharing. So I do this thing at DAHC, which is Dorchester Arts Housing Collaborative, which is which is part of Rebuild Foundation's program. I've been doing it for about 2 years, and it's called Work on the Sabbath. And it began because I was really interested in how to talk about what it is that I do. Because I'm always trip up about it, you know. So what kind of song, what kind of an artist are you? And I usually go, well, I sing songs. I sing. But there's more in it. It's really about sharing. It's really about engaging. It's really about moving something from here out. You know, it's a sacred thing. You know, so I found myself when I was about 2000. I'm kind of going all around the place, but this is why we're talking. In around 2000 to 2005, I was involved pretty heavily in the poetry circuit here in Chicago. Mojo's Pen, I don't know if people know about that. Some Like It Black, things. I was doing music that other people did. And what happened was I was on covers, and people would expect me to do these covers because they like to hear my voice reimagine other people's music, other people's music. But what I found was I was not doing or writing my own songs. I was not sharing myself, you know. So an opportunity with the Astor came. Black Monks of Mississippi, and we've been touring different museums all across the country, around the world. And I've had an opportunity to really experience what it is to be me. You know, so so this opportunity for me, and I think for us, is one where we get an opportunity to really dive into ourselves so that we can affect other selves that need to be reconnected, not only to this community, but to, you know, to their inside. So that's where I'm at.
Great. So we have a very diverse group of people here to welcome you tonight, some of whom are, I'm sure, artists, and some of whom are scholars, and some of whom are both. And one thing about both the scholarly and artistic world is that there's often this posturing of having to pretend like you know everything in order to make your bread, right?
Yeah.
And in my opinion, one of the best things about art is the practice of not knowing or inquiring or being confused. So I'd love to ask each of you in this safe space here to talk about what is confusing you right now, what questions do you have, what anxieties do you have as you enter this residency, what do you want to know, and none of us will judge you for not knowing everything. And also, just as a note, feel free to, like, you guys don't have to go down the,
sure.
the flow, the line.
I'll start.
Yeah.
That's okay.
Sure.
I'm really really would like to know, I mentioned it when I was speaking, I would really like to know what the relationship is between the university and the community. I want to know what the community, how the community feels about the university, how the university feels about the community, and how the university sees us. Now there was an application process, and we said we were going to do all these lovely things to engage with the community and say, hey, you know, we're going to knock on doors and, you know, make everybody happy. But those are just words, you know. A certain kind of action needs to take place. And I'm really curious about how the university sees us as those individuals of change, of building bridges. I'm also really inquisitive about like the divide between races. And I say races because, you know, it's a construct, you know, it's made up. But, you know, like I've been watching people. When I walk down the street, I've been really trying to engage people in their eyes. And I found that, and I don't know if it's because of the election results. I don't know if it's always been there, but I've been feeling lately more of a distance between people, more of a divide. And I really want to engage that question. I really want to really get into the meat of that. I mean, there's so many questions, but we've got a time limit.
So I'll share. So I have two things that come to mind immediately. One is this question of just diving deeper into the history behind the Black radical tradition of healing and understanding like my place within it. So I'm also an entrepreneur, and I've identified as that quicker than I identified as an artist until recently. But now I think the two are intertwined. I think all artists should be entrepreneurs. But I think that I'm really interested in just like the time and the space that now I'll be able to have and be supported and through resources and obviously financially. Because of this residency, to be able to explore those things. Because the past 2 years, I've honestly just been running on autopilot, because you have to, when you're actually trying to build something that's going to last, pass you, and, you know, like, change culture, and, like, feed people, and employ people. So I haven't really been able to, like, sit and, like, just read, you know, the Yoga Sutras, and then also read, like, some Alice Walker, and then also read, like, about, you know, local folk in Chicago who were here before me doing similar work, because I'm not the first one doing it. And so I'm just really interested in that. And then also I just find like the timing of me receiving this residency and being nominated for it very like divine, quite honestly. I think that it's just a time, I mean, I think Black people and people of color have always existed in a kind of crises, and we've like survived and thrived despite the obstacles. But I think that obviously where we're headed is quite scary. And so just the timing of the work that I'm doing and the necessity of it, whether you recognize it or not, it is a necessity. Preventative self-care, preventative wellness, healing, the list goes on. It's a necessity right now, and so all of my questions kind of just revolve around those things. So how are we going to continue to survive and thrive? How can I support folk in that? How can I make myself a better and stronger and more useful kind of like tool slash facilitator of that, and just all the questions related to the history of it.
Thank you for that question. I'm very much interested in my everyday actions in some regards, whether it's enough, whether it's not enough. I'm interested in responsibility to some degree, whether I'm responding appropriately. I think as a visual artist, I'm very much interested in the power of presence, whether it means anything, whether it becomes something that's just quantitative and a number or something, or whether that show of force or that visibility introduces power to others, you know, through hope or action. And I think what is most interesting about this residency with the two neighborhoods, so to speak, is that it offers an opportunity where there's this kind of transparent exploration that I'm capable of approaching and simultaneously sharing, hopefully in conversation with others, where I may be introduced to a particular truth or so in which mine may fail in some regards. And I think at this point in time, I want to place myself in a position in which I am either introduced to that failure in relationship to others with those kind of similar interests, or potentially find something that kind of works and possibly suggest that as maybe a mode of possibilities or something that could carry further.
Please do, yes.
So, just something additional. So my parents came here in like 73 and 76, something like that. And if it is true that my parents, from Ghana, if it is true that my parents and my ancestors were always in Ghana, at some point my ancestors were able to witness their family ripped from them and brought here, right? And I don't think we talk about that trauma, like the trauma that also resonates and is reverberating in Africa. Right? So, and the reason I even think about that is because there is something in me recovering, discovering my voice, my own voice. I hear, and a lot of people hear, pain. Right? You know, and that is the thing that I, that's like my base. There's pain there. And I wonder if that is in the blood. You know what I mean? I wonder if that is, you know, so I really, another question I have is just about how trauma affects the voice, you know, and how the voice can also be an instrument for healing, you know. I just wanted to.
Well, I think it's interesting that each of you in those responses, in some way, engaged this concept of place, right? And in some ways, this residency is a place-based residency, not only in the surrounding community, and as you've noted, you're potentially supposed to be like a liaison between this troubling institution and the surrounding community in a university that is of Chicago, but very much in many ways not of Chicago, right? So could you talk a little bit more about how you see the role of place in your work and what you foresee as your own engagement with communities, however you define that? And I read all y'all proposals, so there were some very specific things.
in a time like this, which is not really unlike a lot of other times, it's just the time that we're in now. There have always been marginalized folks. There have always been folks that we've been like, nah. And I think that when we think about how this residency is placed in the Washington Park community or Hyde Park community or Bronzeville or however far we might reach, I really think a lot about how I look. And what I mean by that is, if I'm presenting, and who I'm presenting, what I'm presenting, when I am here, and I say, I want to curate a photo exhibition that really highlights Black fathers. But I think a lot about how do I make those into words. Come on, words. How do I make the conversation with a family, with a father, and when I say, and if I say, hey, I'm a resident of the University of Chicago, will that shift some things? You know, will that go, oh yeah, okay. Uh-huh. Yeah, so, you know, and this is just my idea of what they might believe. Perhaps in the community of Washington Park, people think that the University of Chicago is doing great things and is, has always had the community's back, right? So, but I do think in the very unique place that we are in and that we are supposed to do our work, you know, how does my position as a resident for the University of Chicago, how might that change or affect my work? You know, how might that shift how I engage? Because, we're supposed to engage. We're supposed to really, I just think a lot about that, you know. And, I mean, obviously I'm gonna have to deal with that question a lot as we, get through this residency.
I'm actually thinking more of how can I propose kind of a shared experience or possibly a project in some regard where throughout time as a born and raised Chicagoan, thinking about these two neighborhoods in particular, I've seen shifts with very personal firsthand experiences. I think what is consistent are particular stories from particular people, from communities, and to be specific in terms of community families, individuals who are consumers, individuals who are owners, and I'm very much interested in finding a way to show some form of visible record outside of our daily kind of digital spectrum landscape and things. And I am trying to figure out how can an everyday person in some regard, include myself, be able to take, say, the memory of an individual who may not be of interest of being casted in bronze or something to stand 50 or 100 years in a particular space, but how can something such as myself in this particular residency, with the assistance of research, learn of someone who may have practically fallen off of the spectrum, find someone who is remotely familiar with this individual, some kind of similarity in some regards where there can be some kind of conversation or a line between these two nodes, and then begin to construct maybe a profile that may be an amalgamation of some sort of a type of person who may be reflective of an individual of these particular communities who has been present, resilient, you know, through time in these spaces, and beginning to question whether that can be something shared among others with proper practices or so that are common and familiar to us, to, I think, show forms of representation of individuals who may be reflective of residents over a period of time.
So your question again is related to like how our projects engage the notion of place.
Yes, either
New Chicago, Southside.
Exactly.
Okay.
Or however you're thinking about that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, yeah, I found it kind of hard because I think that I'm like, I think what you were talking about, Yaw, with feeling like distance between people. I mean, I think that you might agree that there's like varied amounts of like distance and proximity between certain people. So I feel a lot more closeness to Black people as a whole right now. And so I'm really looking forward to seeing also how that may or may not play out in the relationships that I do build with people who do live over here. I don't live over here. That's a difference that we all have. So I live in Pilsen. And I haven't yet lived Southside. It's definitely on the radar. Looking forward to moving here hopefully next year or the year after, but I think that like through I'm someone who like primarily I love to just engage with people just as a rule, like I'm a people person, and so I am looking forward to, you know, seeing who shows up for the first self-care Sunday that I'm planning on doing in January. You know, is it going to be people that are just used to me and the work that I've been doing for the past 2 years, or is it going to be an overwhelming response from the local community in wellness, self-care, and doing that within a culturally specific space, regardless of like, you know, me not being someone who's already been really engaged in this community, although I have to some degree, but and then I would say too with the I'm planning on basically creating like an EP, so to speak, with audio meditations on them, guided audio meditations. But I've been thinking more recently around how I can engage local people from the community and also sharing, you know, a mantra or a affirmation that's really rooted in their experiences and being really intentional about it, not just being my voice, but incorporating other voices into that project.
So what you're saying is you're going to have a guided meditation mixtape that you're going to be outside. Well,
it's going to be free, so I've already decided it's going to be free.
So you're not going to hit
not even
and ask me for $5.
No.
Okay. So my final question for you, and then I'll turn it over to our lovely audience, is something that each of you has intimated in different ways. So we all know that Black artists since time immemorial have really thought critically from different directions about what it means to occupy our particular position in this country or in this world. And, you know, some folks are pivoting that question around the election right now, but as you have intimated yourselves, these are much longer standing questions, right, going back to the Negro artists and the racial mountain, and this is something that Black artists have always had to think about. So these questions of representation, of context, of biography, and each of you occupies your own intersectional positions as part of this diaspora. How are you thinking about Black art in this moment, or about the role of Black artists in this moment, and the paradoxes and implications of that position? Mm-hmm. Go for it. I'd like to undo the hegemonic linear pattern.
Yes, I'll go after.
Free. I'll go after. Be countercultural.
Personally, personally, as I mentioned before, I'm born and raised in the city and all, and I can totally relate to everybody. Everybody at some point in time had an uncle, cousin or something who used to draw faces or something along those lines, and you know, may have been pretty good or not, I don't know. I was very much attracted to that, and I used to practice that as well.
Like representational portraiture.
Representation of portraits and things. Then, you know, you begin to go to museums and things, you come out of school, and at some point in time, representation is almost like the taboo. And I still have questions about that. I'm still really trying to explore ideas of, like, one of my favorite artists, Norman Lewis, you know, who does these beautiful abstractions and things. You know, you dig further and learn that he was a social realist and very much invested in some of the same concerns that I have today. And so there's this large question mark in terms of, you know, at what point in time did the representation of, say, someone like my mother or, you know, someone like, you know, your neighbor or so, became, I don't know if it's less attractive or less of interest, less valuable in some institutions and things. However, I'm very much concerned at this point in time to present it, and not just present it, but also create along with some visitors, you know, whoever's popping in and things of that nature. I'm very much interested in exploring kind of the powers and how something may be presented with the likeness of individuals who are within the surroundings in some ways. So,
that's a very interesting question, because even as representational images of faces are considered taboo in high art institutions, at the same time, for many people, that is the definition of what art is, right? If people say, if you say to somebody, I'm an artist, they say, draw me, right?
Yeah.
And your ability to draw them with an accurate representation is a measure of your estimation of as an artist, right? So what about y'all?
Yeah, for me, and yeah, I appreciate all your questions tonight. We received these questions beforehand, so everyone knows. And when she sent
that's
me this one, I loved it. But, like, not even that far in advance.
So. Like, at 4:30.
But I really love this one. I really love this one, because everyone does have a different understanding of what it means to be an artist. And I think it also changes over time. For me, it really makes me think of James Baldwin said a lot of fantastic things, but something that he said in relation to being an artist is the same as being a lover, and it's this like persistent practice, I would say, of making you conscious of something that you don't see.
Mm-hmm.
And so for me, that's always been the case, back to when I really first started engaging intentionally within both art as well as social practice, with the young people that I work with at Minerva Theater Company. We were examining the world, we were examining people within it, communities within it, structures within it, and asking ourselves and those entities, you know, like, to wake up, to become a little bit more conscious, and aware, and upon becoming more conscious and aware, then doing something about it. And so I think that through this residency, I'll be doing that of myself as well as of the people that I engage. So I think that just being ever more conscious and aware of, like, how I can better hold space for especially people of color to practice wellness, healing, self-care, how I can somehow thrive, not just survive,
mm-hmm.
in this new political era that we're going into, and just being bold enough to continue to ask that of myself as well as others.
At the Columbia College Glass Curtain Gallery, there's a show called Silos, and there's a video, the reason I mention it is because it really, for me, talks about, it's a video of my family. And it's also a video of the the liberation and frustration of assimilation. You know, so I struggle with this a lot. My sister knows, but my inability to speak the language that my parents speak. You know, and it's you know, but you just gotta learn. You know, that's no crux. You know, I can't speak the language, so, you know, give me $1,000 every month. You know what I mean? You learn the language. There's no, and I think black art, blackness is different. It's a very personal, peculiar, and it's unique to who is carrying the art. You know, it's not, I don't think it's like a, you know, a wash. This is black art. You know, I'm black, so I'm black. You know what I mean? I'm actually brown. You know what I mean? There's certain things that I think that we kind of take for granted when we talk about black art. The reason I bring up the video is because I'm showing a Ghanaian experience from the view of a Ghanaian American who is outside of the experience but so on the inside. You know what I mean? There's all these different nuances that I think will be challenges as well as moments of beautiful breakthrough for this residency, because I think we're going to be able to interface with so many different types of black people, so many different types of people. You know, the idea of black art is something that I'm privileged to say that I could be a black artist, but, you know, the work to be able to make the thing is what will distinguish each other, and it's a lot. It's very colored. It's a rainbow. It's very layered too, you know. So first of all, you guys should go see Silos, but
Glass
second of all,
Gallery.
Glass Curtain Gallery, 623 South Wabash. So you know, like, I mean, when I think of the work that I have the opportunity to do, I often don't think of black art. I don't think black. I mean, I don't think that's not where I enter. You know, somewhere along the way, you know, I go, oh wow, this came out the way it did because of the stuff that's in me. You know, but how I enter it, you know, I enter it because I want to be really excellent. I want to do excellent work. And I think that the excellence is what makes the body of, you know, black art, if we will, or art, you know, excellence. So, yeah.
That is wonderful. Well, I'd love to give all of you an opportunity to ask some questions, and we have about 15 minutes to do that. If you don't get a chance to ask a question today, I hope you will come to all the events that will happen throughout the year and the opportunities that you have to engage with these three wonderful people, and also talk to them as we eat snacks together. But for now, questions. Yes, hi. Could you say your name?
Dina.
Hi, Dina.
Hey.
I didn't know you were back in Chicago.
I came to say. I have a question for Lauren. I'm curious about how...
It's at a moment. So I'm glad that the question was for me.
I'm curious about how your work has previously, or the scope of your work moving forward, might speak to black folks who don't typically think about yoga and meditation or might be completely unfamiliar with it.
Mm-hmm.
And sidebar question, how you might be considering faith spaces as a way to reaching out to black folk in that sector who have traditionally looked at church and faith as you know, traditional form of self-care.
Yeah. Both of those questions are great. Again, it's great to see you.
Everyone else, you have a question?
Yeah. So to the first question, which is about being able to engage folk, especially Black folk, who might not view like meditation or yoga as an entryway into wellness or self-care. So I love that because I have understood since nearly the beginning of cultivating Black Girl Known that yoga and meditation isn't for everybody. Of course, like I'll always encourage. But like for one reason or another, it's just not. So those are two ways that I love to practice and that I have found have kind of like just woken all of me up in really great ways. But I think that one way that I'll continue to do this is just by asking the questions to other people, you know? Like maybe a great approach before even doing any program here might be to just have like a community conversation about what wellness does already look like. Because I think sometimes too within like the wellness space, like we, and I mean we very vaguely and broadly, but we can often just assume that like wellness and self-care have a lot to do with like, or that wellness and self-care is attached in some way to like a lot of privilege and is attached in a lot of way to like money and like access. But at the end of the day, I very much view a lot of things that some folk might not even realize as a wellness practice as a wellness practice. Like, you know, really simple things that don't cost a dime and that don't have anything to do with like whiteness or capitalism. So I am really interested in that question and will definitely be putting it into practice, I think, before doing a public program. And then to your second question about,
engaging faith communities.
Oh yeah, so I haven't thought about that, but I have at the same time. So I haven't thought about it in the sense of like, I've never thought like, let me go to this church, let me talk with someone who does go to church regularly about like how we can blend these two, but we recently for BGIO added Dion Ivory to our team. I wish she was here right now. But she is very, very vocal about her faith. She is Christian. And I've already told her, I'm like, I'm really glad that you're on the team. I'm really glad. She's also going to be joining the BGIO podcast for a second season. And I think she is someone that like has honestly made me think more about the faith question. I think about a lot of things from a spiritual perspective more than like a specific faith tradition, even though there's so much to talk about even with yoga and faith. And so I think that, you know, talking with her about it more intentionally and then also talking with people of other faith traditions. Like I've had some, not personal friends of mine, but people that I know of who have come to like yoga sessions who are Muslim. And I think there's just like a conversation waiting to be had.
Yeah.
So thank you for that as well. Yeah.
Other questions? Yes, hi.
Hi, I'm Sydney. This is a question for all of you. But you were talking about like relations, or like you were saying, you were talking about James Baldwin and the relationship between like love and art. And I was interested in like when you're dealing with anger or when you feel anger, if you do choose to put that in your art, like how do you choose to do that? Like, do you take a step back and like think about the anger that you're feeling, or do you just like let that anger show through your art?
Did you all hear a question?
I talked earlier about pain in my voice. I think of a process that I like to do in my work is to really sit there until I go somewhere else. So, I might ask, and I've performed often with a good friend of mine. His name is Kahari Lindywell, and he plays the cello. And he might sit, I might ask him to sit on two notes, and we will just sit there until we go somewhere else, you know? And I think that that's a really good way for me to, it's been a great way for me to actually understand what it is that I do, to actually be able to carve out, oh, this is this is my voice, this is what I do, this is how I feel when I do that, and this is now the time to move here, you know. So, yeah, just staying there.
I would say, honestly, I don't know if I've explored anger intentionally through my work yet. I think that when I get angry, I just like let myself be angry for like a couple days, vent about it to some friends. Chelsea, you know. And then I move on. So I think that this is an interesting lead time question, and now I'm going to, and then I'll have to get your information and I'll let you know. Really though, let's talk afterwards.
Thank you for the question. Anger excites me, you know, because this passion, this energy, you know what I mean, that a lot of times is just is misdirected in some regards. And I know a lot of times that's real easy to say. However, you know, with this residency, I really want to take some of the ideas that people are frustrated with, and similar to what I was saying earlier, I question whether my anger is being appropriately directed to the right people and things of that nature. And so I want to take those ideas and kind of have them alongside of notions of love and begin to think about how can this excitement and this passion be redirected in ways in which you know, the anger can be operating through this very physical labor in some ways, providing a service to operate for love in some regards, you know, and it even feels weird talking about love in some regards because it's seldom, you know, spoken, I think, publicly, or I don't know, it's just weird, but that's even an exploration right there, so.
I love what you said, so I actually take back what I said. We're doing a Yaw now. Yaw, you did this earlier. It responded a little later.
Okay.
Now. So, actually, I mean, you mentioned and praised, thank you, Party Noir.
Yes.
Which is focused on Black Joy. It's a monthly day party that I co-founded with Nick Alder and Ray Chardonnay. And I think that through Party Noir, honestly, and focusing on Black Joy is a really radical way. And I think it's actually in part, like subtly focused or subtly connected to like the fact that we can't all carry around anger all the time, so we gotta let it out.
Sure.
And dance is a great way to do that.
Sure.
Like connecting with people is a good way to do that. I mean, one of my like most amazing moments from this past year was it was our party in, well, it was one of our parties from the summer, but it was one of the weeks where just like I feel like every day that you looked at the news or on Facebook, there was like another Black man who had been shot. And our party was that weekend, and we ended up, realizing just like in a tragic way, but it was a well-timed event because like you just felt the energy between everybody at that party, you know? And it was, again, Black joy amidst a lot of trauma and pain and anger, but it was like the space that we were able to really hold and personally receive so much from, but seeing how much it meant to other people too. So I think thank you for mentioning the kind of the connection in a strange way between like love and anger, you know, because it does exist.
I think we can do one more question. There was one over here. Yes.
So I was curious, like we talked about community and like being part of the community, like in Hyde Park and like the surrounding areas and like being on the south side. And I was wondering, like, for each of you, what your thoughts are of being, like, kind of transitory members of a community and what that looks like to be, like, almost like a temporary person that's coming in and coming out. And both as a resident, like, at UFC and also just as you're in part of your practice as an artist and as a human being and like, what that looks like.
Did we hear the question? The question was about being a transitory member of the community as an artist and a human being. Which I think there's some presumptions there that I don't know are true. But
So, thank you for the question. I'll follow my comrades and say thank you. I'm not a transitory part of this community. I went to Shoesmith, went to Lewisburg. Mm-hmm. I went to Kenwood. You know, so I'm from Chicago. You know what I mean? You know, so I travel a bit, and people, you know, I meet people, and they're like, yeah, I'm from Chicago. And I'm like, oh, yeah, where are you from? Elk, you know, and I'm like, yeah, I'm from Chicago. You know, and the thing is,
But you're specifically, I mean, Houston is on 51st Street, right? Like, you're also from this immediate region.
Oh, yeah, yeah, I'm from, yeah. So, I'm from this room. Where are you? My mama had none. So, that's me. Repose. So when I think of actually being a part of this residency, it's actually a homecoming for me, and I'll say this, I mean I mean this is what, my third or fourth time applying, you know what I mean? So, you know, this is like it's like a breath, you know, and it's also. It's work. It's a labor. You know, it will be a labor. I mean, I'm thinking about it right now. I'm sweating right now. But you know, so this is home. This is home for me. So I just want to get all in the house.
That's such a great question. One that to me is still kind of informing how I define community in some regards, from multiple levels. You have statistics that to me are amazing and surprising, because you can look at numbers and it may not directly reflect your everyday interaction. I think about how the term community today is this kind of word that can be a variable for multiple things depending on commodity and a number of things. In terms of time and temporary, that right there is a meatball in some regard, because through the span of time, I could think about myself too as a Kenwood alum, maybe about 10 years ago or so, I used to desire to be at the school so bad I'd sneak into lectures and things. And I'm like 10 minutes away. Nonetheless, thinking about butting that against an individual who may have been here 5 years and lost their home or something, you know, the question of time is really one that sheds light on how to define community. Who can I relate to, and then what is their representation in some regards, or what, you know, what do they associate their identity with? So there's a bunch of questions right there.
Yeah, I think this does bring up a lot of questions for me. So when you're speaking about the University of Chicago, two things come to mind for me. So one, I realize that I'm more so coming here and concerned almost wholly about people of color, and specifically Black women, and apparently the results of the climate study came out and no one really cares about me or my people. So when I think about University of Chicago, I think about a tiny segment of us who are here, staff, administration, and students who don't feel welcome here. And even though I'm not a part of it, I can relate, because I went to a white institution that didn't care about me, and my sister goes to a white institution that doesn't care about her or about her mental health issues. I also think about, as you were saying, the community at large, which is very key, and I think we spoke about this before, or I responded to your question before, which was in relation to place, and I think, again, I'm going to enter all of my interactions here, I think, with more questions than assumed answers.
I am sad to say that we have to stop there, but happy because we can all share food and drink together and you can continue to have conversations with all of our artists. Please give them once again a warm round of applause.